My talk will focus on what we call the ethnic lens, namely the tendency of especially quantitative integration scholars, also social network scholars, to interpret their results and their data through an ethnic lens that assumes that ethnicity is really relevant. And sometimes this leads to a tendency to overinterpret the role of ethnic background in the school context. The two studies that I'm going to present are part of a larger research project, the Social Bond Project, which is concerned with this big question of how we can build a community and social cohesion in ethnically diverse societies. Our focus is only on adolescence and the school context, but researchers agree that this is a really formative period for identities and social relations. So this is really an influential context, and therefore it deserves our analytic attention. Theoretically, we start from theories of ethnic boundary making, or more broadly from social boundary making. And social boundaries basically are people's distinctions and definitions of group membership. This could be gender, this could be class-based, this could be based on anything basically. And the idea is that we ask how these boundaries are drawn, which attributes become meaningful in social life for identities and for social relations, for example. And this deviates a bit from a standard research process, especially in quantitative large-scale social science, where you start from a distinction between a native reference category and certain ethnic minorities, and you take these distinctions for granted. To some extent, of course, one always has to do this, but at least the ethnic boundary making approach tries to endogenize these group distinctions, to really see when certain backgrounds become relevant and when they are not relevant, right? And my claim will be in my talk today that many studies adopt overly ethnicized accounts of what is going on in the school context. The first study that is already published, and some of you might know, therefore I try to be relatively fast in covering the results, is on violence, because I also wanted to provide some information on violence, namely on physical violence in the school context. It starts from a common assumption in research on ethnic segregation and friendship networks, namely the assumption that the tendency to prefer same ethnic peers over inter-ethnic peers can be problematic because it could be the symptom or a cause of negative intergroup relations. So if you have more ethnic friendship segregation, this could hinder the reduction of inter-ethnic prejudice that comes with contact. It could trigger also feelings of threat or superiority if you don't have positive frequent exchange with members of other groups. Or it could even lead to victimization between groups, right? And one example study here in 11 countries, for it's really typical of the stream of research. What they did, they found basically in their regression analysis that immigrant school composition, so a greater share of immigrants or students with an immigrant background, is positively associated with levels of physical fighting and bullying for both immigrant and non-immigrant adolescents. And how do they interpret this correlation? Well, they turn to social psychological theories like threat theory or social identity theory. And these theories posit that a higher number of immigrants in school may lead to greater tension between pupils, enabling greater in-group out-group competition for resources, social status, or identity. And accordingly, higher percentages of immigrants in school are related to more ethnic group friendships or ethnic homophily. So they find that when the share of immigrants is higher, you have more segregation in the friendship networks. And this, they interpret, might be associated with fighting and tension occurring on an intergroup basis. The problem is, however, they don't know who is fighting with whom. Yeah, and this is basically why it's important to have really network data, as we collected in our study. But in the interest of time, I might even jump directly to our study. So what we did is we conducted a large-scale panel study in the Ruhr area in Germany, which is really densely populated, ethnically diverse area. So these are five adjacent cities here, Gelsenkirchen, Gladbeck, Recklinghausen, Marl, and Herten. And we conducted a panel study here. As I said, it was really without the involvement of an external survey agency, and the quality of the network data is relatively high. And we asked not only who are your best friends in your school grade, but we also asked about negative ties. So dislike means which of your schoolmates do you not like at all? And then they could nominate from a list those students in their grade for which this is true. And we also, which is something that is rarely asked, inquired about violence relations. So which schoolmates sometimes hit or kick you, and which schoolmates do you sometimes hit or kick? Yeah, so this is our measure of physical fighting, and we made clear to the respondents that it's not just for fun, but that they should focus on serious incidences. Okay, so what do we do with the social network data? We apply exponential random graph models. I don't have the time to go into details here. Frank Halter, fortunately, described these methods a bit in his talk. So that's, of course, as a correlational in the end, right? It's similar to a logistic regression for those who don't know it, and ask what are the main mechanisms that are responsible for a certain network structure, and whether there are certain network structures that are more frequent that would be expected by chance alone. And basically from this higher frequency, you infer which mechanisms might be responsible for the network structure. And what we found in our ERGOM analysis is first, that as expected, dislike and violence are very different negative ties. So what you see here in these figures on the x-axis is the shortest path distance in the friendship network. So how far away is someone else in the friendship network, right? He is maximally close if I'm friend with someone, but it could be also three steps if he is the friend of a friend of a friend, basically. And as you can see, the more distant another student is, the more likely it is that I dislike the student. Maybe because I avoid contact with him, right? Maybe because I lack the possibility for positive experiences. Or maybe because the dislikable attributes of my friends are something that I try to resolve with cognitive dissonance reduction, right? So usually friendship means you have a reciprocal positive affection to one another. And this doesn't come with dislike usually. Okay, but with violence, it's the other way around. And the more distant someone is in the friendship network, the less likely it is that I engage in violence towards them regularly. And the reason that it is relatively frequent that you have fights among friends is basically because they spend time outside school also with each other. So in unsupervised, unstructured settings. And that's simply a question of exposure and the likelihood of provocations that come with it, right? So this is really the friendship embeddedness of dislike and violence is very different. And what does this mean for ethnic origin? Well, as you can see here, ethnic origin plays a really different role for dislike and violence. On the left side, you see for each school in our sample, a dot with a confidence interval attached to it. And it shows you from these ERGOM models the coefficient for intra versus inter-ethnic ties. And because you can see that across schools for dislike, the red dotted vertical line is the average tendency, and this is negative, meaning that it is more likely to have or less likely to have intra versus inter-ethnic ties and dislike. So put simply, it is more likely to dislike an outgroup member. Yeah. Whereas for violence, you see it's the other way around. On the right-hand side, it's more likely to behave violently towards someone from your own ethnic group. And this is, of course, in contrast to the motivating study I showed you in the beginning. It's also interesting to relate ethnic homophily in friendship networks and this tendency towards fighting within your own group versus across group boundaries. And what you can see here is, in line with our theoretical interpretation, that there is a clear positive relation. The more segregated the friendship network is, the more likely also the violence takes place within groups, right? Meaning that this dark side of ethnic homophily in friendships might have been overemphasized in the literature. At least it is not necessarily indicative of inter-ethnic violence in normal, peaceful times, right? I'm not talking, of course, there are other instances where this could become problematic and the basis for more fighting, but not in these normal, regular times. On the other hand, we could also adopt the point of view of this integration paradox framework and see that, well, if there is little friendship segregation, we also see more fights between students of different ethnic origin, right? Because to the extent that integration is successful and you have more cross-group friendships, you will naturally also observe more conflicts taking place between students of different ethnic origin, right? So we shouldn't also have two alarmized accounts of such incidences. Okay, so this concludes basically what I wanted to show in the first part of my talk. Dislike and violence are very different negative ties, and such of all categories as negative ties are problematic, if you want so. And it's really important to think about the underlying mechanisms. You saw that ethnic origin plays a markedly different role for these two types of negative ties, and that basically ethnic segregation means that this takes place both in friendships and in these physical fighting relations. Okay, the second study is relatively new, so it's basically work in progress. And what we did here is we used data from a new panel study, a second one that we also conducted ourselves in the last years. So it's a three-wave panel study, although the last wave has been compromised by the corona pandemic quite a bit. So we are only going to use data from the first wave in this analysis. So it's in Northern Westphalia, located in 39 schools. And our main goal was here to more fully realize this idea of de-ethnicized research designs. So what are de-ethnicized research designs? These are designs that start from non-ethnic units of observation, as a regular survey would do, because they start from individuals as units of observations. And it's also true for social network analysis, which starts from ties also as between individuals as non-ethnic units of observation. And the advantage of such research designs is that they are open to the possibility of ethnic closure and its absence, as Wimmer stresses. And there are other designs where you study ethnic communities and assume from the outset that ethnicity is really a major organizing principle of social life. When you study ethnic neighborhoods, ethnic clubs, and so on. And this is basically problematic, but interestingly, all the social network analysis in principle is already a de-ethnicized research design. We as researchers often invoke social mechanisms that presuppose the high relevance of ethnicity without really checking whether this is the case. I mean, I already illustrated this in the first study I reported, but there are also other studies that argue that, for example, having out-group class peers leads to a heightened awareness of ethnicity and feelings of ethnic threat, as long as you don't have strong ethnographic evidence of this taking place and just rely on social psychological work on intergroup phenomena, I think this is sometimes too strong a claim. So to go beyond this and to be more open towards the possibility that ethnicity might not be so important after all, we try to come up with new measures in the study that allow us to assess the subjective relevance of ethnicity empirically. And one such measure refers to the cliques that students perceive themselves in their school grade. So that's again in secondary school, right? Like think about 14, 15 year olds. And our question was, in some schools or school grades, there are groups or cliques of students who are hanging together or spend time together during breaks. do such cliques or groups also exist in your school grade? And then we asked who belongs to the first group or clique, who belongs to the second group or clique, and then they could use again this list to tell us which classmates or grade mates they think are part of these different cliques. They could list up to 5 different cliques and in each case assign up to 10 members, and they provided rich information on their perceived cliques in the school grade. And we didn't stop there, but we also asked them to describe these cliques. Can you give this clique or group a name or describe it? You can also try to describe what its members are doing together. And we basically developed a coding scheme for this and also checked inter-rater reliability, of course, and had student assistants categorize these descriptions and labels of cliques. And I just give you some examples here in German from what the students answered. So the category gossip are things like some of them is always talking about others, or they are, what is less than again in English? Yeah, basically they're distributing gossip about others. Hobby, the category is, for example, the gamer gang. They're talking they're talking all the time only about a video game. It's really boring, and I prefer to talk to my friend about math. Yeah, someone answered of these students. And then we have also ethnic or even racist labels. For example, if they describe cliques as the Romanian gang or the Germans, they are always looking out for trouble. They cannot do otherwise. Or the black students. Yeah. The interesting result is that such ethnic or racist labels are really rare. Yeah, so this gives you the relative frequency of these 19 categories. And as you can see here, so the usual suspects of sociology, socioeconomic status, neighborhoods, ethnic differences, are really rarely used by students to describe the social structure that they perceive in their school grades, right? Gender is relatively often, as can be expected, given that it is such a strong organizing and segregating principle in secondary schools still. But it's really much more often that they use neutral descriptions or say, well, they are just talking to another, or they are characterizing them by a certain hobby, right? So this is the first remarkable descriptive result of this new measure. And then basically what we did is we ran a linear probability models where we tried to predict when a clique will be perceived or will be labeled as ethnic. And this could, of course, vary with the attributes of the one who is labeling the clique. It could be associated with characteristics of the whole school grade, such as its size, ethnic diversity, and so on. And it can be associated with characteristics of the clique. And we can get at this characteristics of the students in the clique because we ask them which students are typical members of a clique, right? And what we see here, the strongest effect basically is, or the strongest association, is the share of Muslim students in the clique. And they mean, and you can see this, the higher the share of Muslim students in the clique is, the higher is also the share of those students in the clique who identify strongly with their country of origin. So Muslim students are more likely to identify with their country of origin. And this basically is also related to a paper by Lars Leczynski and Sebastian Pink on the relevance of ethnic identification also for friendship. So we follow up on this earlier work. And what we can, and basically the most red dots and are to be found in the upper right area of this graph. Right, and this these red dots are basically those cliques or perceived cliques that get assigned an ethnic label, right? And so it's much more likely to be the case to think about a different or describe a group of students as ethnic if it's composed of mainly Muslim students, and which comes also with a rather strong ethnic identification by those students. And this, of course, could be indicative of othering towards students, right? Muslim students. And I mean, there's a strong research also on in qualitative methods that shows how these phenomena affect students. But it's important to keep in mind that it is really rare. Yeah, so if you look at the regression coefficients, you could say, okay, we now describe how being a student with Muslim faith and leads to othering. But on the other hand, it's just 60-30 cliques out of these 1,473 cliques in this upper right corner that get assigned an ethnic label. So even if you are in a clique and with other co-Muslim students, it's most likely that you won't become othered or perceived in ethnic terms by your co-students, at least according to this measure. Okay, for those who are interested in social networks, we also look in how far ethnic homophily, as is usually measured based on these ergums, as we also did in the first study, whether this is related to the share of students who mention ethnic labels. Because you could think that in school grades where ethnic homophily is stronger, students also perceive of their environment and the other cliques in ethnic terms. So this would lead you to expect a positive association, but as you can see here, there is no clear positive association. Yeah, so basically what we are left with is a certain divergence between what network scholars find and what students basically perceive. Yeah, the more objectivist perceptions of network scholars is that ethnicity is often of considerable relevance as indicative by this net segregation or ethnic homophily, how it is sometimes called. But of course, this could be an over-interpretation. It could be that there's just a larger likelihood, a greater likelihood to befriend same ethnic peers over other ethnic peers because you're more likely to live in the same neighborhood. Or even if this is measured, it could be the case that you are more likely to live in neighborhoods that are so close to each other that you share the same way to school, yeah, the same tram or the same bus line. So we hardly are able to really measure completely possible confounders in terms of opportunity structures. Yeah, so it could be that we should be really more reluctant to talk about the social psychological preference for same ethnic peers, because it could be just other opportunities that are not captured by our measures. Student subjective perceptions basically show us that ethnicity to them seems to be of relatively little relevance, although there are a few exceptions. But of course, one can also criticize this new measure, right? One could also ask whether students might underestimate or might not be willing to be open about the relevance of ethnicity because it is kind of a taboo in the German school context, right? On the other hand, we saw clear examples of strongly worded labels. So at least that's not true for all students. So this is basically where we are left and where we are also very eager to hear your comments. Because this is where we are at the moment. And at least we hope to constructively irritate network scholars here that are concerned with ethnic relations in the school context with this study. Thank you very much.